by.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Safari Live. We are situated in South Africa in an area known as the Northern Sabi Sands, a place called Juma Game Reserve, which is part of the Greater Kruger National Park. Very, very large area, almost 7 million acres of land. You are currently live on safari with us, and what a fantastic way to start with this female elephant and her calf. They've been digging around here for a few minutes. It looks as if they're feeding on some roots, digging up some of the nutritious roots and smaller leaves that they can get from those fantastic trees over there. My name is Byron David, and on our other vehicle got my old friend James, and he is with Viem. Good morning to the ladies in the FC. We've got Lou and Rebecca. So hopefully it's going to be another fantastic drive this morning. I'm starting this morning, so it's a very different feel for me, but it's great to be here with you. So let's see. It's always fantastic to be able to start with an animal like this and see what they get up to. Don't forget to send us your questions through Twitter at hashtag SafariLive, or alternatively email us with questions at wildearth.tv. Quite a nice morning this morning. Temperature is about 14 degrees Celsius, which is about 57 degrees Fahrenheit. So not too cold for a winter's morning. A little bit overcast. I think that's why it's a little bit warmer. Often the clouds just trap in a bit of the insulation from the evening, keep things warm early in the morning. But I'm sure just before sunrise, the temperature could drop a little bit again. This female and her calf, very relaxed. They've been standing here for about 10 minutes now, feeding. I don't see or hear any other elephant in the area, which is unusual. Often the females and the calves are in herds. But perhaps they've just moved off slightly and they may meet up with the rest of the herd a little bit later. Quite a few birds calling in the distance already, starting their morning calls. We had some Franklins very early this morning. And then the ground hornbills, which I understand you heard yesterday morning too, seem to be calling again quite far. I'm not too sure you would be able to pick it up. You can just hear the low booming sound of the southern ground hornbill. Did you see how that elephant used her foot to break the roots? They're very, very skilled feeders. They're able to kick and loosen roots with their feet. The little calf got a bit of a fright there from the female. As I mentioned, it's quite interesting to see this female and her calf alone like this. I'm not too sure exactly why that is. Occasionally elephant drop back out of a herd, maybe just don't catch up as quickly. Again, I don't know if there's a specific reason, but I'm sure the rest of the herd or another herd is not too far in the area, and I'm sure they will meet up with them at some point again. Looks like that calf is suckling a little bit there. Just trying to see, it looks like it, yep. And that's quite an old calf, probably about 4 or 5 years old. So good morning to Shanson, who's just asked us a question about the adult female and about that wet substance you can see being secreted from her temporal gland just behind the eye. The question was whether or not that liquid is stress related. So it's a good question. Often you will see that very prominently in large dominant males, and that is often a sign that they are in must. That's a term which is used when the males come into mating phase. They are ready to mate. They've got a lot of testosterone running through their body, and with all these hormones and testosterone, they start sweating from the temporal glands and between the legs. In the case of this female, I think it's not necessarily always related to stress. It can be a sign of stress, but also it may be a sign of a few more hormones running through her body. I have also read that it can also be related to the elephant being happy. Currently, there is still a lot of food around. There is still some water, so I don't think these elephants are stressed. I don't think in this situation it's related with stress at all. I think possibly perhaps just a few more hormones. There you can see it very clearly now. Very interesting. Good question. Good morning to Betty Sleep. She is asking us about the hair on the tail of the elephant. Betty has asked, have they always had that hair, or is it in fact hair? Yes, it is. It is hair. There's quite a thick tuft of hair at the base of that tail. And Betty has asked if perhaps at some point the elephants had hair all over their body. It's a good question. You know, I think millions of years ago, if you think of elephants probably are related to the mastodons. And if you have a look at those were very hairy animals. So very possibly due to climate change and that, there may have been hair on these animals a few million years ago and subsequently have evolved to very little hair on these large bodies. They don't necessarily need the hair to keep them warm. If you look at animals like the predators, antelope, and then all the way down to gerbils, then you'll find those animals are covered in fur and hair to keep their bodies warm. Their metabolism is a bit higher, and they need to rely on as much as possible to keep them warm. Whereas the elephant, it's probably not necessarily an issue. So I think in this situation, elephant may have evolved, especially in Africa, to very little hair, but they have still got that very prominent tuft of hair on the tail. They have just moved off into the thicket, and they're slowly moving off. Georgie has just asked us a question about the calf and how old I think it is. So Georgie, it's always difficult to gauge how old an animal is. I mean, we can read books and try and get size differences. I think this calf is between 3 and 5 years old. That would be my guess. So not a young calf, quite old, and it's interesting to see this one still trying to suckle. And again, elephant, and especially elephant calves, they do try their luck. I've seen up to 6, 7 years old still trying to suckle from their mother. And again, I think they just want to get the nutrients, as much nutrients as possible from the female. But it's funny. It's an interesting situation. And this calf, I think, with it being close to the mom, still trying its luck and trying to suckle a little bit. They have just moved off into the thicket. So I think, why don't we continue and see what else we can find. As I mentioned, it's been a great morning. Been hearing some birds and that. It's always nice to stop in a situation like this where you can listen out for any alarm calls or potential predators calling very early in the morning. Why don't you cross over to James, let him say good morning to you, and see if he has got any update for you.
Hello, everybody. Good morning. I have no updates for you. I have driven along here to Biffleshook Dam and found nothing. Not any form of heartbeat. But it is a very interestingly grey sort of morning, and I shall inform you of my plans to find you great things. Now, my name is James, in case you're wondering, and on the camera today we have Viem. Hello, Viem. Talk us through those pants. Ski pants, good.
Not like spandex.
Right, not spandex ski pants, ski pants. That's good news to know. I think the thought of VM in spandex is, it's deeply disturbing. We're as live as Byron is, and so you must send us your questions, hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. And our plan this morning is to go towards Cheetah Plains. We did come past Biffleshook Dam, in the hopes of finding something there. We did see a hippo, it disappeared, and we also saw some lion tracks, but we don't think that they're very fresh. So we're going to continue down towards Cheetah Plains, and maybe we'll be lucky there. You're most welcome on our little drive, our little jaunt, our little exploration here. And I'm glad that you've already seen some elephants. There are some lion tracks here. I suspect quite strongly the same ones we saw. Yeah, crossing over the dam. It's a big male lion here. But he's underneath. No, he's not. He's on top of the hippo. But he's underneath an elephant. He's also underneath one of the cars. Or is he? No, he isn't, you know. He's on top. I think it's worth maybe just doing a little bit of a jaunt around here, just to see if this chap doesn't pitch up. I'm pretty sure this is the same track that we saw going across the dam wall. We'll just do a little loop around there. You think the other one was a female? I suppose she was, yes. This is a male. Maybe a little turn around. I'm just going to turn around here, everyone. Viem, of course, not only a fine cameraman, a very fine tracker. Now, the lions we know of, the Inkahuma pride, we know five females. One of them definitely on Torchwood, looking after her babies. Then there were three lions found on Biffleshook yesterday, and three lions found on Torchwood, and one lioness found on a kudu kill. Or two, maybe even been two lionesses on a kudu kill inside Simbambili yesterday. And they were called in as the Inkahuma pride. So I don't know how many Inkahumas could possibly be here on Juma. But maybe we shall be lucky. Maybe the Torchwood ladies decided to bring her babies across. Anyway, let's go and see if we can find a male lion quickly. Why is that bird shouting? Ah, thank you, Anna Marie. I couldn't agree with you more. You say I really deserve a good cat sighting this morning. I agree completely. Thank you. Hopefully that will happen. The male lion track's definitely going down this way. Drove straight over the top of them. Probably dipped down through here towards the edge of the dam. But maybe not. Of course, predicting where animals go, as I've said before, normally gets you much egg on the face. You know, he's not here anymore. I don't see his tracks. Do you, Viem? There, no. And lots of buffalo tracks around here. Not particularly new ones, but when animals go down to the dam, they often take a little game path and they wander down here to the edge. I mean, sometimes the lions like to lie the other side. And a comment all the way from Kenya. Good morning, Nicola. Nicola, I hope you're having a very nice time over there. You will all remember Nikki Austin. She's clearly sitting doing a couple of emails in the office in Kenya and being a little bit, distracted by the fact that we're out on the bushveld. Well, it's lovely to have you with us, Nikki. Wim, say hello to Nikki.
Hello, Nikki.
There we go. Nikki, do you know where the lions are? If you do, could you tell me? Nikki, of course, a remarkable naturalist from the Final Control. She used to spot things from there that we didn't. Let's just stick our heads through here. Been out for the tracks. Here's the male lion track. It comes straight out over here. If I find a decent one, I will show it to you, everyone. He's popped out right there. So he's not down at the dam. What about there, Vim? Do you see him there? Yes, you do. But he's going the other way, isn't he? Right, there you can see the track, everyone. I wonder if he didn't just turn around here. Let me point it out to you. Can you see it, Vimpy? This is a female. This is not the same track.
Yeah, my lens got stuck, James.
Your lens is stuck. I mean, we can't do this. We need to link away.
Yeah, we need to link away.
Oh, I'm so sorry, everybody. We're going to keep looking for this lion, try and fix the lens. Rebecca, you're going to have to link to Byron. I'm so sorry about this. And we're going across to Byron in 3, 2, 1, go. Welcome back, everyone. I understand James has got a little bit of an issue with the lens. The joys of being in the middle of the bush live and having all these technical issues. I'm sure they will get it fixed soon. I understand he had some tracks at Biffleshoek Dam. That's line tracks. That's fantastic. What have we got there, David? Can you see? Just buffalo tracks. David and I are on a mission this morning to try and find a leopard for you. We've been listening out, we've been having a look carefully at the road, trying to see if we can get any fresh tracks. Nothing yet, but it's still early, and what I always like to say is it's too soon to panic. You never know what you're going to find. Temperature definitely dropping a little bit now. As I mentioned earlier, it was about 14 degrees Celsius, but just before sunrise, the temperature definitely drops quite a bit after that. And then should hopefully warm up quite a bit later. Don't forget to send us your questions, please. Hashtag SafariLive if you're on Twitter. And email us questions@wildearth.tv. Myself and James will hopefully get through all your questions this morning. Oh, we've got a branch in the road. I'm just going to move that quickly. While I do, go back and see if James has got his lens fixed. Hello, everybody. Sorry about that. Vian broke his camera. I beat him severely, and now it's back, and it's fine. Here are some tracks, but these are not as fresh as the male tracks that we saw. And the reason I know they're female tracks, the reason I know that they're not fresh is that they've got little spits of rain on them, and if you follow them a little bit further along here to over here, which I'm not sure you'll be able to see. Can you see here? There are a whole lot of bird tracks on top of them as well. And so they're definitely not that fresh. It only rained, I suppose it may have spat a little bit in the night, but I don't think it did. I actually think it spat only yesterday afternoon. So I don't think the female is fresh. I can't see where the male's gone. It looks like he wandered around there somewhere. What we're going to do is just head down the road there. We did come up that way. If he's gone that way, he's almost certainly crossed onto Biffleshoek. So let's just head down here and see if we can't find a few more of the male tracks. The male track is about the same size as my hand. My hand is not very big, given that I'm not very big, but it's bigger than your dog's sort of paw, if you like. Female just slightly smaller than that. Right, on we go. I've plugged in. But I would rather not spend too much time here. These things are not smoking fresh, simply because we want to go to Cheetah Plains and explore the great clearings there and see what's going on. Nice soft sand here from all the earthworks that have been going on restoring the dam. And that means that we should be able to follow them when they're around here. I'm just not convinced of how fresh they all are. Let's follow down this way. Hello, Rebecca, did you click something? I just heard a beep. Hello, Karen in Tanzania. Sorry, I'm just seeing some white bushes through there. At least white wood. It's very weird. Karen, you want to know how well animals heal out here compared with human beings? Well, I think they heal really well. And not only do they heal very well, they compensate very well. So they compensate for their injuries extremely well. You'll find animals with all bits and pieces of themselves missing. Somehow they manage to get by. My favorite example, which I've given before, of a two-limbed monkey that was surviving. So it had lost one of its feet and one of its hands, surviving absolutely fine. We were asked the other day about an elephant, whether there'd ever been a three-legged elephant. And I said, no, I didn't think that was possible, because I didn't think an elephant, because it cannot jump, would be able to walk on three legs. And as is the case so often, as soon as you make a definitive statement like that, one of the viewers sent through a picture of a three-legged elephant living in the wild in the Aberdares National Park in Kenya. Maybe Nicola Austin can go and visit that three-legged elephant. So even an elephant can do it. We've seen three-legged hyenas. And so I think also what you find is, with regards to parasites and diseases, we have, as human beings, have cultivated diseases that affect us in our cities. Unwittingly, of course, but animals don't have that problem. Byron has found some living fossils. Let's go and have a look at them.
Have a look what we have found here. A beautiful herd of impala. Still out in the open. Which is very interesting, and the reason behind that often is a lot of these antelope species like to come out into the open clearings in the evening, and the main reason is for safety. It's because it is so open, it's easier for them to glance around and keep an eye out for any potential predators that might be in the area. There was something else I noticed which I'd like to show you. Just trying to see if I can see it on one or two of those impala now. If you have a look at that one that is standing facing the right, and the one that has just walked behind him, exactly those two, just over there. Have a look at, it's quite interesting. Often the impala generally have this beautiful sheen to their coat. These two impala look as if they have been brushed the wrong way. Can you see that? That is a very interesting adaptation that these impala have. What they do is they have tiny muscles in their skin, and they contract these muscles and cause the hair on their back to stand up. What this does is it then traps air, warm air, underneath those hairs, those hair follicles, and that acts as an insulation to keep the impala warm. As the day starts warming up, they will relax those muscles, and the hair then falls down again, and they have that beautiful, smooth, sleek sheen, which you are used to seeing on impala. So especially in the mornings, cold mornings like this, you'll often see this impala with this ruffled look, or this hair that is standing up, and it looks like they've been brushed the wrong way. There you can see it clearly on that one now. Look at that. See how much darker it is on the back. It's grooming itself. This looks like a young bachelor herd. There were one or two adult males, but the entire herd consists of males. And these younger males, you can see those horns aren't quite fully developed yet. And it's not unusual to find bachelor herds of impala. Males generally do stick together, and the females with all the younger impala stay together, often with maybe one or two dominant males, until the rutting season, where they then compete for dominance over the females. They really are beautiful antelope. Fantastic coloration. It's quite interesting. While we are watching this impala, you can see one or two of them are grazing. So they're feeding on the grass on the ground. And then a few of the others are browsing. They're feeding off leaves of trees. And that is one of the reasons why the impala, there we go, there's one that's browsing at the moment. That's one of the reasons why these impala are so abundant within the greater Kruger area and are so successful. They are mixed feeders, so they will feed on just about anything that is available. This obviously helps the diet and keeps them healthy, especially in the winter when it is a lot drier and there's not much grass for them to feed on. They will browse and feed off the trees. And a good food source for a lot of predators too. So often if you've got a healthy impala population, you're most likely going to have a good predator population because most predators will feed on impala. But it is not always easy to catch them. They are very fast, very agile, and they can get away very quickly. Very alert antelope, constantly on the lookout and listening. Their senses are incredible. Have a look at how that tail every so often flicks backwards and forwards, maybe just chasing a few little flies that are around the rump, and then they tuck the tail back in underneath. So peaceful here at the moment. Beautiful, beautiful morning. As I mentioned earlier, it's great to stop and listen out. Listen out for any potential predators or alarm calls that we might hear. Good morning to Chris Pye. Chris, you're a new viewer, I understand, and you would like to know what country we are in. We are in South Africa, right up in the northeastern part of South Africa, in the Greater Kruger National Park. We are in an area known as the Sabi Sands, northern part of the Sabi Sands. We're on Juma Game Reserve. So welcome. Hope you enjoy and continue to follow us and view with us in the mornings and in the afternoons. I think we will leave these impala now. Let us continue and see what else we can find. Hopefully we will get some tracks along the way. David and I, as I mentioned earlier, are on a mission for leopard this morning. So hopefully we can have a bit of luck. You never know. Let's go back to James and see if he has got any updates for us while we continue our search.
See the tracks of these lions, everyone, are now heading straight down this road, and at the top of the apex of this road, of course, is Torchwood, into which we may not go. But the lions, of course, are able to go there at will, and so they do. Don't know where that male went. This is the female, and I'm sure it's the female who's got her little cubbies at Torchwood there, or on the rocks there. She'll make little forays in here every so often, maybe to have a hunt. maybe to have a drink, although there's water in Torture, so I'm not sure why she'd do that. Anyway, we'll turn south now, down the Cheetah Cut line. I see Byron has started where he left off last night, i.e. embarrassing me by finding things while I drive around, making the place look entirely uninhabited. Do you think that's beginner's luck, VM, or do you think it's just because I'm incompetent? Careful how you answer.
Yeah, I don't care, as long as you see cheetahs.
Okay, you just want to see cheetahs on cheetah planes. Right, so be it. So we're now on the eastern boundary. To the left, Torchwood. To the right, Juma. Anne in Canada, you're asking about the drought, and you say, is this the first drought? I think, well, the first or the worst drought. We had a drought. We're not really in a drought now, in so much as the fact that we wouldn't expect to have rain between April and November. We might expect one sort of smattering of less than half an inch, maybe, in that time. But because the rainy season before that was so poor, with about a third of the normal rainfall, and I use the term normal very loosely, because the rainfall here doesn't really flatline. You know, if you look at a graph of rainfall, it does go up and down all the time. So, I mean, yes, it is dry. We will only really start to feel the drought, I think, probably from about now. As we go into the winter time, there just isn't much forage on the ground. If you look through there, it's largely sand. You can see the leaves have all turned brown and gold. And so between now and the rainy season in November, if we get rain in November, is when we're going to have a tough time. Is it the worst drought there's ever been? Well, there certainly seems to have been one of the worst rainfall years for in living memory since they started keeping records, and it was also one of the hottest. The summer last year was beastly hot. It really was unbelievably hot. And I've lived in this area for many, many years, and I can't remember being as uncomfortably hot as I was this last year. So the heat combined with the lack of rain has made for very dry conditions. I mean, this is nothing illustrates it better than where we're driving along now. You know, normally at this time of the year, if you were to look to the left of us again, Vim, if you don't mind, that is a clearing. I mean, it's artificially cleared, and it's cleared for a fire break. But you would certainly find a standing grass sward of probably 20 centimeters in height. Now, that's about 8 inches. You'd expect to find grass standing about 8 inches high. It wouldn't be great forage. It would be a bit straw-like, so not great, but it would be edible to things like buffalo. It's just none of that now. And so animals, buffalo, I've started to see them browsing quite a lot. They're not natural browsers. They will browse if they absolutely have to. And so I think we're in for some tough times. Vian, there's a dove. Well done. Speed. There we are, everybody. Our first heartbeat of the day. The humble yet beautiful ring-necked dove. Bird of peace, I think. Look at the detail on his feet. Yeah, very nice. Now, a bird like that, when it rests on a perch, I've always found, I mean, before I knew about what I'm going to tell you now, I always found it amazing that a bird could sit on a perch like that and sleep. You know, hold on, it's not easy. It's a bit like, it's a bit like you balancing on the top of a wall, even if the wall is that wide. I mean, to sort of crouch down and balance and not fall off if you're asleep is quite something. But what a bird does, is they've got tendons between the, I think it must be the first and the fourth joints. And those tendons, when the joint touches, when the branch touches those joints, the muscles immediately clamp shut. So their resting position is clamped shut. And so it's not actually straining any muscle, the bird, by perching like that. And that's how they manage to balance and sleep on very thin branches. So, Viam, I mean, our return for the day so far, one ring-necked dove. Are you impressed? Hello, Justin S. You want to know about osprey and when we find them here in South Africa. Justin, we do. Not really in this area, generally in the wetter areas. So if you travel down to the eastern coast, into Natal and up into Mozambique, there you will find osprey in the summertime. In the winter, they go north into Europe. I think they are Palearctic migrants, which means they'll go into Eurasia, into Europe and up into... Where? Well spotted, via monkeys. So yes, osprey, but not really in this area. It's not really wet enough. There is a monkey, everybody. A vervet monkey. Sitting in an obthorn tree. There are four or five of them that I can see. I didn't mean to make that rhyme. Oh, a little baby one. Just go back a little touch. There, you can see them all there. That's a really nice picture. It's very artistic, don't you think, Vian? Now, that is a knobthorn, and I mentioned this yesterday when we saw some monkeys. Unbelievable how they managed to sit in those thorny trees. Goodbye, Nicola. Nicola Austin, everybody's going back to work at the moment. She says she's going to go and look for the three-legged elephant. On you go. Send our love to Scott. He's clearly not in the office today. Good for him. And in case you're wondering who we're talking to, everybody, they are ex-presenters and directors here who are now working up in Kenya. Now, just look at the thorns in that tree and how the monkeys have somehow conspired to be able to sleep in a tree that you and I would not break a branch off with our bare hands. Yet there, the soft bits of that monkey's rear end are very delicately placed upon the thorny branches of the knobthorn tree, and I don't really understand how it's possible. He looks a little uncomfortable, don't you think, Ben?
He's cold.
He looks cold. You don't think it's because he's got thorns in his hands? They're not doing much, these monkeys. Normally they are knocking about the place. I think VM's right. I think they're just a bit chilly, waking up slowly, thinking of where on earth they're going to find breakfast. There we go. We have movement. Now watch it climb down through these unbelievably thorny branches. There's no way it's not touching the thorns. Somehow it just manages to cope with them. And they'll go foraging now. They'll head out for breakfast. They'll try and find themselves anything, basically. They're completely omnivorous. This time of the year, they really will eat anything. They'll eat fresh leaves, sort of fresh leaf shoots if they can find them. Insects absolutely will stand no chance if a monkey comes across them. Eggs they'd love to eat. They'll eat small lizards if they can find them. So they'll forage a little bit like mongoose, underneath rocks and underneath bits of dead bark. And fruit, of course, if they can find it, but this time of the year, no fruit. A little baby there. Very sweet. They are very sweet at a distance, monkeys, in close proximity. Not so much. They can be very deeply terrifying, and as I've said before, you know, all over the camps that there are around the Sabi sand, monkeys are a tremendous problem. And it's mainly because people are a tremendous problem. And I remember where I used to work, just down the road, we'd say to people, there are going to be monkeys around, please don't feed them. Please don't feed the monkeys, because if you feed them, they're going to lose their fear of human beings, and then there's going to be trouble. This lion is now moving down the road here. Not very fresh, though, I'm afraid. And there we go, just exactly what Maria's saying here. Saying that in the US, and if you go to a national park, people will tell you that you can't leave food out for the animals, that you mustn't, that you must, you know, that if animals get hold of the food, it's a really bad thing. And that's exactly what happens here with the monkeys. If they get hold of your food, they lose their natural fear of human beings, and then they can be utterly terrifying. You don't want an angry monkey anywhere near you. Although they look small and cute, they have got vicious little teeth, and they are massively strong. The lion's still there, Vimpy. Right, let's go over a little bit quicker. There is a lion track walking down the left-hand side of the road. Looks like a female. She's still there. This would be very nice if there was a lion on the end of it. Well, there is a lion on the end of it. It's just where it ends, that's the problem. There she is. She had a bit of a lie down there. Why wouldn't she? These look pretty fresh. Might be lucky. We're getting quite close to our southern boundary now, though. She's carried on down here. Maybe in the clearing here, Viam. Still on the road. All right, let's just follow up where these things go. We're just going to go over the next hump. And if she's not there immediately, we'll go across to Byron and get an update from him. I think he is in the vicinity of where we hope that Karula, the great queen, will come out onto Juma again. No, she's not down here. Let's go across to Byron. We'll keep you posted as we go along.
So, James, we are actually in the area where Karula was last seen, but no sign of any leopard tracks yet. Thankfully, James has got some lion tracks. Hopefully, he gets lucky this morning, finding lions, that is. And I know he has gone on to Cheetah Plains, so maybe they have a little bit of luck with some lions. We've had a lot of lion tracks yesterday. I had lion tracks around Biffles Hook Dam. I know James had some tracks here this morning. But it sounds like those tracks that he's got now are a little bit fresher. So maybe we have a little bit of luck this morning. When it is cooler like this, the predators tend to move around for a lot longer in the morning. They do often will walk up to around 9, 10 o'clock in the mornings at times, which is unusual for animals like lions and that, especially in the heat of summer. Generally, they tend to settle down quite quickly as soon as the temperature starts increasing and it gets warmer. I've been searching around little drainage lines, taking odd little roads, because leopards are fringe hunters. They like to move through thickets in areas where they've got good good thicket to hide and stalk. They are ambush predators. So they often move in and out of drainage lines looking for animals like impala or smaller antelope like dacre or steenbok. So it could be interesting to see if we have any luck and if my theory is correct. Beautiful drainage line off to our right. Perfect leopard habitat. For those of you who weren't with us yesterday, we had a very fortunate afternoon. We had some elephant and we found a beautiful owl, which is not always seen on a drive. So it's nice to find these little things. Or this was actually a giant eagle owl, so a big bird, which you don't often see, and especially during the day. James was getting a little bit little bit nervous, saying that I'm finding everything and he has not been able to find anything for you yet. But last night he said he was feeling very proud because he is the one that trained me. So so Good morning, Melissa, from all the way from Canada. So Melissa has asked how long it has taken me to track or learn to track animals, and also decipher whether it's male or female tracks. So Melissa, it takes quite some time. I think to really understand the art of tracking does take a very long time, and often people train for 10, 15 years. If you are in the bush constantly and you are fortunate enough to experience it on a daily basis, it becomes a little bit easier. I've been going to the bush from a very, very young age, so slowly but surely built up my interest, and I'd say after about 2 years or so doing it on a regular basis, I found that it became easier to identify tracks, not just the big cats, which after a while, after 6 months, you can pretty much, or even less than that, you can identify the difference between those very easily. But some of these smaller antelope or larger antelope, those become a bit more difficult because they do all look very similar. So it's give and take. I suppose some people might learn a lot quicker than others. But I'd say to become comfortable with identifying tracks, maybe 6 months to a year. And then it all depends where you go from there and how much time you do spend in the bush following animals. I was very fortunate. I worked with a gentleman by the name of Judas, who still is a tracker, at Londolozi, where I started my guiding, and Judas and I became very, very close friends. And I learned so much from him, his experience. He's been in this bush tracking industry for 30 years and more. So from a very young age, Judas learned to track, and his knowledge and experience is really fantastic, and I learned so much from him. So, Samson, you asked how I became a guide. Well, Samson, it took me some time, and one of the reasons I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do after I finished school. But having gone to the bush and to Kruger National Park and to Botswana from a very young age, I built up this passion and love for being outdoors and viewing wildlife. And I then did a qualification, a guiding qualification, which took me about a year to complete. You go through a lot of the basics, but quite a bit of in-depth information about everything in nature, from the grass and the trees to stars and obviously everything in between. And that just sparked the interest and the passion even more. And so since then, I did that in 2004. And have been guiding permanently for almost 8 years now, so it's a long time, but that's kind of how I got into it and got started. What I love most about the guiding is being able to take people from all over the world around on safari in Africa. And look what I found. I found a gems.
Yes, well, now listen to me very carefully. Hello, everybody. The reports of dogs and Mvula, the male leopard.
Yes.
Now, Mvula, the male leopard, is on Triple M.
That is the east, far western boundary. You with me?
So I'm fairly new, so I need to learn the roads. Okay. Yes, James, I'm with you.
And the dogs are north of that, probably somewhere on Sandy Patch.
Far western
boundary. So we're going to head that way. Would you like to try the leopard?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
You'll be able to get hold of them on the Channel 5 on your...
Handheld.
On
the radio.
No, not your hand.
Sorry. Yes.
Good. Okay. I'll keep you posted if I hear
you. The western boundary, sir.
Yeah, western boundary.
Fantastic.
Okay. Enjoy, David. Maybe not. Good luck. Maybe use your app.
All right. Goodbye, James.
Good luck.
Off you go. Well, that's exciting news. So, reports of a leopard. Let's head into that area and see if we have any luck. Well, James heads over to an area where there are reports of wild dog. So, exciting morning. Things are starting to happen.
Hello everybody, so that's very exciting stuff you heard there. We have the prospect of Mvula on the western boundary, so on the Triple M break between us and Simbambili at One Eye Pan, and then also reports of the dogs. Now obviously, if we're going to get to the dogs and if they're still moving, well, chances are they've crossed north into Biffles Hook already. They might be on quarantine clearings, who knows. So we're going to head that direction. And one or other of us, hopefully, will get to the leopard and perhaps will be very lucky and have the dogs as well. In the interim, since I last saw you, we turned round on our way to Cheetah Plains on reports of these animals. So we're going to go down here and just see if we can't pick something up this side. And I'm just going to ask Rebecca to tell Byron that the sighting is being run on Channel 5. So that's the sighting of Mvula, Bex. If you won't just tell Byron, it's on Channel 5. And there's at least space for one person, so he can probably go straight in there. I'm just listening to the radio quickly, finding out what Lex is doing. And we're just enlisting the help of Yours from from Biffles Hook. And he's going to try and help us find the dogs. He's coming in from the north. We're just doing this road because it's quite a good one. Well, it's the kind of road that Karula might pop across onto. So we've come across here and then we'll head due north. And Lex said he had some impala alarm calling around here. Hello, Shelley. A nice question from you. You say, in what year did we here in the Sabi Sand start naming the leopards? I don't know when Karula was named. I imagine probably not too long after her birth, but basically with the advent of tourism, leopards here started to be named because they started to be recognized. Now, leopard viewing in this area was pioneered by Mala Mala and by Londolozi, and Londolozi's leopards were made famous by John Varty, one of the owners, and he habituated a leopard who was now known as the mother leopard. Actually with Lex Hess, who's driving as a guide here at the moment. He's a private guide, and the two of them habituated the mother leopard, and they called her the mother, and then from there all of her offspring and her entire lineage was named, and that was in the sort of late 70s that they started doing that. So I guess you could say the late 70s. Tourism up here in the north started a bit later than that, and down in the south they don't give them names like we do here, where with, you know, Karula, George and Charlotte, for example. There they normally name them either after a piece of territory in which they live or after their spot patterns. So it'll be the 3-4 female or the 3-3 female or the Mshaben female, and they always kind of put the sex at the end of it so that to sort of depersonalize it, if you like, so to de-anthropomorphize it. I don't think it makes any difference to the leopard whether it's called the 3-4 female or Charlotte. But that's basically the story of the naming. And I think certainly with the advent of media in these areas, so social media now, we know that instead of one or two documentary watches or just a couple hundred documentary watches, there are now thousands of people watching the fates of the animals of the Sabi sand. They've all got Facebook pages, and there's a whole community of people around the world who've never been here and hopefully who will come here one day, following and enjoying and reveling in the lives of these wonderful animals. And so the naming becomes all the more important and people become all the more invested in it. And I would caution you from becoming too invested in the naming process, because of course well, that just doesn't make much difference to the animals what they call, does it? I don't think. You don't think they mind you?
No.
No, I don't think they do.
They need a nice name.
They need a nice name, do they?
Yeah.
Like Dark Shadow.
Yes, like
Dark Shadow. So Viam wanted to call the new cubs Dark Shadow and what was the other one? Demon Slayer. Dark Shadow and Demon Slayer. I just don't think that's going to go down well. There's a huge elephant. A very large elephant bull who's listening to me waffle on. And if you watch his head, you can see how his head is lifted, his ears are turned, his eyes are now turned. And you can also see how his hips are showing. And that's not ideal. That's an indication that he's nutritionally deficient. He's got little stubby little tusks. Poor fellow. I think size does matter to a certain extent when it comes to tusks. He seems a little bit forlorn, depressed. I suppose if I had the prospect of 3 months of trying to get 300 or 660 pounds of food a day out of this landscape, I'd also be looking a little bit forlorn and depressed. It's so nice to stop after you've been driving hell for leather after a while, because the sounds of the bush really just infuse you with a sense of peace. Doves. Alarming impala.
You know.
Yeah. One alarm call.
I've had two.
You've got two? Where?
Earlier. Just when we stopped, there was no alarm call.
What was that? Kennedy, while we listen to see if those impala are going to continue alarm calling, you want to know how long do elephants live in the wild? Kennedy, probably about 60 years in this area, potentially up to 65, in areas where the food is a bit softer than it is here. Remember, here they eat a lot of wood. They have to grind a lot of bark off the wood. And that means that their teeth start to, they wear out faster than they would in a place like the Okavango. Everybody, we're going to carry on and hopefully see these dogs. I don't want to let them get too far away, and this elephant looks a bit depressing. So they crossed onto Oyatela, which is Juma, or the farther Juma is on, now it's 15 minutes ago. Now we know how fast wild dogs are, we know the kind of ground they can cover, and in 15 minutes they can go a very long way, unless they kill something, in which case they'll feed, play around, and then go to sleep. So with any luck, they're about to do that here on quarantine clearings as we emerge. It would be so very... The best thing, of course, this time of year is if you have a pack of wild dogs actually denning on your reserve, because then you have wild dogs every day for 3 months, and it is the best thing in the world. But I don't see any terrified impala streaming across the plains. I'm just going to keep them updated as to which route I'm taking. Yours and Lex, I'm checking quarantine and then heading up Oyatela access. So this area called quarantine clearing, so named because animals were quarantined here before their introduction some many years ago. I often think people must think it's very odd that we have an area called Quarantine. It's not the most romantic name, you know. Not like Little Serengeti or something like that. Sorry, I have to stop here, VMP. These starlings are too precious. They were too precious. There were six of them until VM jumped in his seat. Six beautiful Cape Glossy starlings. Now, keep an eye out here in the clearings. And Stephanie, you want to know why Quarantine the leopard is named Quarantine? Well, he's named Quarantine because he spent so much time over here. That's the only reason. Spent much time lurking about on these clearings. Okay, no impala here, which is quite interesting. On a day like this, I wouldn't be surprised to find some impala lurking about while it's a bit blustery and cold. Maybe we'll find them trotting down the road here. Must just keep an eye out for tracks. I will be so excited to see them again. It's been a long while now. Shamsun, very nice question. Why don't the cheetah get named? Same reason that the wild dogs don't get named individually. It's because we just don't spend as much time around them. I suspect if we did, we would certainly name them. And yeah, it's only because we don't spend, the sightings of them are so irregular, they are so un... There's a female leopard. A female leopard going up the road here. That's worth just keeping an eye on, everyone. So Shamsun, while we know where the leopards live, we know what the extent of their territories. Their territories are small enough for them to be contained by one or two properties. And she's still going up the road here. So that's why and how we can name them. But the cheetah, you know, those two male cheetahs that we see, I suppose we could give them a name. But they're just not often around. Go ahead, Lex. No, nothing. I'm coming up Voyatela Axis. I'm at Junction Zoes. I'm going to continue in a northwesterly direction. So tracks of a female leopard in this area. Let's just keep going here. So the dogs crossed basically in that direction. They came this way. Just keep an eye out for the tracks. The leopard is still on this road. Just need to keep an eye out there because if they do come busting through here, chasing something, they'll cross the road almost invisibly. It's almost like they fly. No, they haven't come across here. There's no sign behind us. Leopard is still on the road. These are very fresh leopard tracks, everyone. Could be Karula doing another territorial patrol. It's not impossible that it's Shadow who's wandered through here. Let's just keep an eye out for both. It would be so nice to see either. Impala. Looking pretty chilled out to the max, but he is looking into the bush. Now, impala, of course, will not alarm call when they see dogs. They just start running. Like that. Rather like that, but normally followed closely then by a whole lot of wild dogs. Leopard is still on the road. Keep going. Excellent. Byron is in his first sighting of wonderful Mvula. Let's go take a look.
Guess what, everyone? We have found Mvula, this beautiful male leopard. Have a look, quite close to us, just off to the right. Fantastic. I'm so excited. Oh, that is incredible. He is a beautiful specimen. Looks like he's got quite a full belly. One of the other reasons why I'm so excited is I have been very fortunate in my guiding career to follow and track and find many different leopard in the Sabi Sands area. So I generally know leopard behavior quite well and quite a lot about leopard that I've seen and witnessed that you don't often read about in books. So it's always fantastic to find something, especially like a leopard, that you do know quite a lot about. But again, there's never ever a guarantee. This male looks like he has been lying around in some elephant dung. Do you have a look at that? Very interesting. One of the reasons why leopards like to do that, and I've seen them roll around in elephant dung and buffalo dung, and I think often what they do is they try and mask their scent a little bit. So they roll around in this dung, masks their scent, and they're able to move around through the bush fairly undetected. He's most likely been moving around quite a bit during the evening and has just decided to lie down and rest for a while. Often predators will do that. But as I mentioned earlier, when it's cool weather like this, they will go off and move around for a lot longer periods in the morning and during the afternoons, and not rest in the heat of the day like they do in summer. Again, we're lucky it's a cool morning because he is right out in the open for us. We've got a beautiful view of him. Good morning, James Richard. James Richard has asked a question about leopard and my various leopard stories and sightings. So last year, as James Richard has mentioned, there was I was photobombed by a leopard while on Safari Live. We were at a hyena den and a leopard popped up in the background, which was very exciting. James Richard, I've got many, many different stories about leopard. As I said, I've worked in the Sabi Sands area for about 5 years. So, and the leopard viewing in this area is fantastic. So stories from tracking leopards where they literally jump out of a bush 5 meters from me, where we just haven't seen them. They're very elusive cats, to seeing leopards make kills and mating leopards with cubs. I've been very, very fortunate to see a lot of leopard activity. Well, David and I are very happy. We said we wanted to find leopard this morning, and we got one. How fantastic is this? I'm so excited. Look at that, every now and then just lifting his head, looking around. They are very, very alert animals. And even though it looks like he's resting or sleeping, he's still completely aware of what is going on around him. Magnificent animal. I could sit here all morning and watch this male. Often I've found how patience is important with animals. And, you know, with waiting and sitting and being patient, you often get to see animals doing stuff that you wouldn't normally see, because people might say, oh, you know, this leopard's sleeping, let's move on and see what else we can find. But sitting around viewing animals for long periods of time, you get to see amazing behavior. Samson has asked about this leopard and him looking like he is quite full, and if he has a kill perhaps in the area, and if we can smell anything. I cannot smell anything, and I don't see any remains of a kill in this area right now. So he may have had a kill yesterday afternoon or last night that he finished up somewhere, something small, or a steenbok. And I think he has moved away from wherever the carcass is, because there's no sign of anything in this area. I can hear another Varroa's eagle owl, or giant eagle owl, calling in the distance, just behind the leopard. We heard yesterday while we were with the elephant, heard these owls calling, and we actually managed to find them. This one I think will be a little bit harder to try and find. It sounds a little bit further away. It's always nice to hear these different calls when you are sitting in a sighting. It gives you so much to speak about. Just appreciate what's going on around you, not just this beautiful leopard, but everything else. So, I'm not too sure. I don't know too much about this male leopard. I'm not sure if any of our viewers can perhaps give me a bit more information about him. Is he the territorial male of this area? He looks like it from his size, so I would guess. But if anyone has more information for me, that would be greatly appreciated. Good morning, Marsha from Oklahoma. Marsha has asked if leopards are more intelligent than lions. Now, Marsha, to be honest, I don't know. and I'll tell you why. I think it's very difficult for us to gauge the intelligence of animals at times. We can judge by behavior and I suppose to an extent, but also, do we really understand their thinking? Both predators, lion and leopard, fill a different niche. So their roles in nature are different. A leopard is a solitary animal. It is an ambush predator. It stalks. It's very secretive, unlike lions. Lions often hunt in prides. They are more social. So they do fill different roles. So their behavior will be different. I have watched lions hunting, and it is incredible to see how they work together or as a pride when they're hunting. So there's definitely a sign of intelligence there that we don't really understand, but can pick up when you see that type of behavior. I've also seen leopard hunting and working out which direction a herd of impala are going, and they're moving around and ambushing from the other side. Both animals learn their territories very, very well. They know exactly where to find water. They know which trees are prominent trees that they scent mark on. Leopards will know which areas, females for example, will know which areas are good den sites. So I think both of them have a very high intelligence that we kind of understand, but maybe don't have a great understanding. I don't think one is more intelligent than the other. I think they are probably quite equal. So Sandy has asked about those beautiful spots or rosettes on the leopard and those very prominent dark spots or rosettes on the belly. If you have a look, those are quite large. And if all leopard have got those, yes they do. All leopard have got this type of coloration or spot markings. Everyone is unique though, so they are all different, just like our fingerprints are different. The spot patterns and the rosettes on leopard are completely different and unique, but very, very beautiful. Sandy also asked about the paw size of this male compared to lions, or a lioness rather. So the male paw of a leopard is quite large and is very round. If you have a look, Sandy, I would say that a male leopard track is about that size, roughly, a nice round big track. A lioness track will be slightly larger than that though. I mean, a lion is much, much bigger. This male leopard could possibly weigh between 70 to 80 kilograms, that's for a very large leopard, which is, what's it, about 170, 180 pounds, I think. Whereas a lioness is probably closer to 140 to 160 kilograms. So twice the size of this male leopard. So their tracks, I would say, are roughly around that size. So slightly bigger, but are definitely much larger and a little bit more elongated. The leopard has a beautiful, nice round track. And then male tracks or lion male tracks are much larger. Maybe around that size. I've seen some really, really big male lion tracks. Hope that answers your question, Sandy, but yeah, definitely this male leopard track will be slightly smaller than a lioness, than a full-grown lioness. Colin, thank you very much for your comment about Mvula and him being a 13-year-old male leopard. So generally male leopards are in their prime from about 7 to 12 years. Males can live up to about 15 years, but they'd be in their prime around between 7 and 12. Colin mentioned that Mvula has been displaced by another dominant male, Tingaan, in the area, which is quite interesting. So it's really great to see him around and be able to view him like this. I hope James has got an update for us on the wild dog. Why don't you go cross over to James? We will sit with Mvula for a while and see if you have any luck with wild dog.
There, everybody, look. It's a guinea fowl.
The wild dogs, I'm afraid, have gone onto Biffle's Hook. They've chased a duiker into a dam just over there. We can't go there. Sorry about that, but we have the guinea fowl. Let us be very grateful for the guinea fowl, which are very impressive birds. There we go. Awesome guinea fowl sighting, don't you think, Vim? Mm-hmm. You must sound very enthusiastic about it. I know you're disappointed about the dogs. It's no excuse. I know the guinea fowl is a humble bird. Just as the sun comes out.
Quite difficult to photograph, James, are you sure?
I am very sure that I'm not going to get a photograph. I didn't get a photograph. VM, you really thoroughly enjoy my incompetence in the camera, don't you? Okay, we're going to go to the hyena den, see what's going on there. I can't believe that I turned round from my jaunt to Cheetah Plains for no good reason, and now it's just slightly late to go and explore there. I will go straight there this afternoon. I will not pass begin. Anyway, we're on the Biffles of Cut line here. In other words, the boundary between our two reserves. The sun has come out, it is shining upon my face, which is very nice indeed. Are you feeling that, Liam? Are you feeling the joy of the sun on your face? Yes. And then those leopard tracks headed off in this direction, like very early last night. So maybe, oh, there was that leopard, of course, that drank at the pan at 10:30. Thank you for that update. That's exactly who that was. That's I'm pretty sure those would have been the tracks. I think could easily be Karula on her patrols. What she's starting to do now is move a bigger and bigger distance away from those cubs, just re-establishing her territory. Because, of course, for a long time, she couldn't go too far away from them. They're almost 5 months old now. So they're in very much, well, I mean, they'll start making their first little kills now on their own. Little birds, lizards, termites. I don't suppose a termite counts as a kill, but to the humble termite it does. Not so. You're the termite, it counts as a kill. The world can be a very cruel place. Let's go down here. And then along the firebreak road, it's just a bit more attractive. Might be a bit more lying down on it. So nice to spend a bit of time with Mbula again. I hope he hangs around, but you know, in his current state, that of a sort of nomadic male, he's going to go wherever the other males aren't. So I'm guessing that Tingana is probably off down to the south. I don't know where Sandita is. We haven't had a ping from his collar for the last little while. Brent had tracks of a male going north into Biffles Hook yesterday, most likely him. Sandile, I mean, not Brent. Brent is now in Johannesburg. I think that's where his wedding is. Not his wedding, of course. He's not getting married. Before I create consternation on Twitter. That would be very funny. I think I'm going to start a rumor. Hello, Sandy in Canada. Sandy, let me just go back here, because I thought I saw some leopard tracks. Sorry, I'm just listening to Byron on the radio. Sandy, oh, they're hyena tracks. We've been doing this since for 9 years. This is the ninth, well, we're into our 10th year, apparently March, I think it was March the 21st or something, was the 9th anniversary, which I think is quite astounding. It's only really now starting to get real traction, though, and it's because the technology has got to the state where you can now watch it in HD. You've got sufficient streaming and sufficient bandwidth to be able to watch it unlimited, which makes it a lot easier. And, sorry, the radio is getting very, not the road, the radio is getting very busy. We've done the TV specials now. They work very nicely. And, I mean, I think the difficulty is knowing when the internet is truly going to take over from TV. And I don't believe that it has just yet. Well, we've been doing it for 9 years. And it started off, in fact, more than I think about 13 years ago, it started as AfriCam, and that was just one JPEG being loaded from the Juma Dam. So you know where the Juma Dam cam is. There was a camera there that loaded one JPEG
image to the internet once every 30 seconds. Isn't that amazing how long we've come quite a long way from that? And I say we. I mean, I'm most honored to be called part of this thing, but I've only been here a year. I should see what else we can see down here now. If we look over here on this tree, we haven't done a tree today, Vian. I know they're your favorite. Look at the termites that have been eating there on the tree. And all over the reserve, these silver cluster leaf trees seem to be being attacked by termites. And now, the wood itself is supposed to be termite resistant. And if you break off a piece, if you break off a little piece of this, you can see that the termites are not getting at the wood. They're not eating the wood. They're eating the bark, which is, I think, amazing. So if you can see where my hand is, Vim, if I break that away, you can see the tunnels. There you can see a little piece of tunnel. And basically the tunnel forms if you like that. Forms on top of the bark like that. You can see there. Yeah? Does that work for you, Vian? Mm-hmm. I've now crushed the tunnel, of course. And the termites are eating the bark. And termites eat dry wood. They eat dry grass. But if you look around us, not much dry grass left. And I think it's only because of the drought that the termites have started to eat the bark off these trees. And this one has been now denuded of the outer bark. The wood has been left untouched, and the termites have now left this tree alone, but for this piece here. They've taken off a huge amount of the bark all over the top of the tree, and I suspect very strongly that they live in this mound off to the left-hand side of us there, over here. So, you'll find that there's always a fungus-growing termite mound somewhere close to where these trees are being hammered, I guess. I've never seen it before. I think it's really amazing. Because the terminalia is an excellent tree if you want to build a fence pole or you want to build some furniture, because the termites generally leave it alone, but not the bark, clearly. Are you so amazed, Vim, by that little factoid? No, just a little bit. He's waving his hand and he's not very amazed at all. Rebecca says she's very amazed. I did detect a slight piece of sarcasm in her voice there. She is Danish, of course. You never can trust Danish people, I believe. Ever since I read Hamlet, I realized that. That touched a nerve. Okay, there is a zebra. You see the zebra, Vim? Let me go closer to it and then we can look at it properly. Byron is still with the leopard, everyone. He's just repositioning the vehicle so he can get a better view. And then you'll go back and have a look at the magnificent Mvula, he of the rain. Mvula is a Zulu word, not a Shangaan word, and it means rain. The Shangaan word is very similar. Mpula. Zebras look very happy to see you, Vim. I must confess, much happier than you look to see them. Hello, Betty, Steve, you say. You'd really love to see baby warthogs today. When is their breeding season? Well, not now, Betty, normally in the wet season. But, there we go. Very nice zebra. But, Betty, you can still see warthog babies, and there were, I saw some yesterday, actually. Oh, Byron has found his second giant eagle owl since he's been here, while he's at the leopard sighting. Let's go across to him.
Welcome back, everyone. So, unfortunately, James was unlucky with the wild dog, but it happens like that at times. especially with wild dog, they disappear so quickly. They can move and cover a distance of 5 to 10 kilometers in a morning very easily and very quickly. But we are still sitting with Mvula. Fantastic to be able to sit and spend time with this beautiful leopard. David and I have been smiling from ear to ear for the past half an hour because we managed to find him and are able to sit and view him like this. As I mentioned earlier, while we were sitting here, I could hear a giant eagle owl calling in the distance. I managed to find it. It's a little bit too far for our camera, but I used binoculars and I found it sitting in quite a large tree, probably about 100 meters from where we are. Maybe if we're lucky, it hangs around there for a bit, and maybe later we'll get a view of it again. Don't think it's the same ones we saw yesterday. We're quite far from that area. This is definitely a different eagle owl, giant eagle owl. So great to be able to sit peacefully and just watch this leopard, and you can see he's completely relaxed with us around, not too fazed by the vehicle at all. Again, we do try to be sensitive. We don't want to get too close. We don't want to disturb any animals, but where we are now, we have not disturbed him. He hasn't even moved, so completely comfortable and happy. Morning, Bob. And Bob has noticed some flies around, and Bob is wondering if those flies, or why those flies are here. They shouldn't be around, because Bob says that elephant dung shouldn't attract flies. Elephant dung does actually attract flies and little flies. But remember, Bob, you get many different species of insects and many different species of flies. You do get, at especially fresh dung, you'll get a lot of midges or little flies and insects buzzing around, because some of them do feed on that broken down plant material, or what they try and do is they get the moisture from the dung. In this situation, I think it's a bit of both. One, there's a leopard lying there, so the flies are most likely buzzing around the leopard, and that's why they are here. And that dung doesn't look too fresh, but it could still be quite a strong smell, and that will attract certain species of flies. Often flies will lay their eggs in dung, and that larva will hatch out of that, so that could also be a reason why they are here. So Roy has asked about the age of the big cats, and if you are able to see grey hair on some of the big cats, so they're not quite like James, who I'm sure every now and then you get a glimpse of his grey hair at the moment. Please don't tell him I said that. But with a lot of the big cats, it's not always very visible to see grey hair forming on older cats. One of the ways you can tell with cheetah, leopard, or lion, if they are much older, you can occasionally see conditioning that is slightly lost the older they get. becomes a bit harder for them to hunt successfully and feed, so you might see a slight condition change. The other thing is mainly around the face. The nose of these big cats becomes a little bit darker, a little bit worn. The right on the front of the nose, the younger cats tend to have a slightly, especially in leopard, they tend to have a slightly pinkish coloration. And the older they get, the darker that gets. But then the other clear sign of animals being older is their ears. So with a lot of the cheetah and leopard and lions, from all the flies that bother them over the years and chew and bite on the ears, you do get the ears becoming a little frayed and bare. The tops or the tips of the ears become very bare and open because the hair has been eaten off by flies and insects. So that is often a good sign. You see, have a look at the ears, and you can then have a rough estimate at if it's an older leopard or a younger leopard or older cheetah or lion. You do see that very clearly. Thank you for that, Roy. We are going to sit with the Mvula for a little bit longer. Again, when you have a leopard like this that is so relaxed, it's fantastic to spend time with him. Let us cross over to James and see if he has finally found you something this morning. I think he has got some hyena for you.
There, everybody, is the hyena mother here. And I see that Byron has left off with from Brent with his highly amusing jokes about the state of my hair, or lack thereof. I'm overwhelmed with amusement at the moment, and you hear it in my voice. Now what she's looking at are some nyala that are walking around to the right-hand side of where she is. But what I'm really hoping is that this is the first time I've seen her up, and I wonder if she isn't going to call her little ones out. I really think it's going to be worth sitting here just for a few minutes to see. She is hugely fat, which means she looks like she's had a bit of a meal. And what an animal like this will do is not bring food back to the den because she's so low ranking. So she'll eat away from the den and come back with that full belly and sort of turn it into nutrients for her cubs via her milk glands. Here we go. Come on. Call them out. Let's just watch her carefully. Oh, no, don't put your bottom back in there. Don't plug the hole. Call. Oh, she's weeing. That's very nice. She's urinating into the hole where her babies live. That's super. Very nice to see. Maybe. Let's just sit here, just listen to the birds calling. Isn't that beautiful? Beautiful, beautiful bird calling. White-browed scrub robin. The sun's just starting to bathe that lovely den site. Something has got her attention, but you know, this female, every time I've been here, has been pretty ill at ease. She keeps getting up and looking around. I don't know that, I wonder if those nyala even knew that she was here. They walk quite close by. Now she looks pretty calm. And I'm sure the rest of the hyenas have probably gone off into the drainage line where I think they spend most of the day. If she can either hear or smell something from that side. What I'm going to do is just move slightly so that you can get a decent view of her face. You don't have to look through the bushes. And she's very relaxed around us. And I really think it's going to be worth sitting here for the next 10, 15 minutes and just see if the youngster doesn't come out. Say when you got a clear shot, Bim Bim. Yes. There, look, look, look. The little baby come out. That's not hers. That's not her baby. That's unusual. She's obviously sharing the den there. That looks like one of the Decembers or Januaries. Probably one of the Januaries if she's still in the den site there. That's fantastic. Wow. Let's see if I can get a magnificent photograph. What do you think, Vim? Do you think I will? There, I got one, Vim. It's a world beater.
We need to ask the viewers.
There we go. Thank you, everybody. That's my photograph. Liam is unimpressed. He's unimpressed because it takes me so incredibly long to take a decent photograph. This is wonderful. I love these hyenas. As Jamie says, they're her favourite predator. I think they're my second favourite, maybe. I don't know. I do love wild dogs. But likewise, I like these things and leopards, obviously. Well, if you're looking at Karula, it's just too lovely for words. Roy, a very nice question from you, and it's an astute question. You say, has there ever been a record of a low-ranking hyena challenging a high-ranking hyena for her dominance? I'm sure there has, Roy. Have I ever seen it? No. Have I ever read a direct record of it happening? No, I haven't. So I don't know for sure, Roy. But I'm going to assume that it has happened, but I think to say otherwise would be silly, probably. She's just looking down there. And Roy, I say it would be silly because nothing in biology is impossible. So many things in biology happen without our knowledge. And those wild dogs, everyone, have gone into the Magnoletti already. Which means they've gone quite a long way. This is fantastic stuff. So I think that is one of the January cubs. And I don't know where her sibling would be, or his sibling would be. I initially thought the two Januaries were two males, but I've spent so little time around them over the last little while. Let's just keep watching. Now, a very nice question that I don't really know how to answer, save to say that they're from different families. A question about whether or not, or what is the difference between an African wild dog and a dingo, Australia. And I'm unable to say the word dingo without trying to put on an Australian accent. It's a sort of defect in my character. And the answer is, I think a dingo is probably, as far as I know, it's like an Australian version of a coyote, unless I've got this mixed up and they are in fact feral. I don't think that they're feral dogs. I think it's a separate breed. Oh, so it'd be feral. Much like a... You think they're feral?
Long ago, like yeah. Thousands of years feral.
Okay. So, yeah, I mean, it would be a totally separate breed. Wouldn't be able to breed with them. Much, I think, probably much more like a coyote or like our jackals. But, oh, look, look, look. The little one came out. The little one's out. Look. Oh, that was amazing. BM, do you think I chased it back in with my loud voice? Mm. Say no.
No.
Good. There, 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 there. There we are. Little one. That is very cool. Just the one so far. Come on, little one. Come back out. I knew it would be worthwhile sitting here. Well, I didn't know. I hoped. Isn't that fantastic? Oh, it's still there, you know. And their mum's getting a little irritated, just trying to protect the baby. Let's just keep watching. And in the background, a southern boo-boo is calling. Beautiful. Let's just wait and see. The sun's coming out again. There, there, there. There's a little one. Which I obviously haven't got a photograph of. Get out of the way. There we are. That's it. Come up. There. Still haven't got a shot. Hopeless. This is brilliant. Isn't this wonderful? Look, the little one's coming out. I wonder if that's all we're going to see there. No, there we are. Oh, the two of them. Did you see? How cool is that? Come on, come back. Don't go away. Come back, little one. Look, Mum's not very happy with the little January baby hanging around there. There we go. Come on. There, we got a shot for him. It's a world beater. The world-beating shot of a piece of black stuff sticking out the back of the hole. Oh, wow. Wasn't that amazing? Chris, nice one from you. You say, at what age do the hyena cubs stop coming out of the, going into the den? Chris, probably only at about a year, you know. I've seen year-old cubs go down into a den. So 8 months to a year is when they'll sort of begin becoming less dependent. But much longer than you'd expect. This is brilliant, people. This is the best sighting we've had of these little ones, and I think these are the youngest cubs we've seen. Their ears are still bent. I don't know if you can see that, but their ears are not straight yet. Now, she's low ranking. Jen Ward, you want to know how old I think they are. Jen, I think that they are only about a week, maybe 10 days old. I don't think they're older than 10 days. Because when Jamie came here a little while back, about a week ago, she figured that there was a cub in there. This is just wonderful. So special. We are so lucky to see this. She spotted or she smelt something else, this mother. She's extremely concerned. Which I suppose she should be. Wonderful stuff. And you just, I don't know if you heard that. She went, whoop. And the hyena's backside there is so dirty because she's been lying in her own urine, basically. Let's see if the little one sticks its head out now. Ah, fantastic. And now the other little one is becoming quite excited. The January one's sort of, I think, quite excited, possibly just in the same way that the elephants become excited by us not being, you know, entertaining itself. The fact that the little one's starting to come out, not quite so boring, just lying there. It's interesting, Sandy, very nice questions about the social structure and what happens with a male and a female cub. Remember, it's a cub, not a pup, for hyenas. Now, Sandy, you say if a high-ranking female gives birth to a male, will the male be lower-ranking than the females in the clan? Absolutely. All females outrank all males in the clan simply by virtue of the fact that they're bigger. Which means that they beat up the males if the males try and take food from them. That said, a male born to the matriarch will obviously be very high up in the male hierarchy, and she won't, I don't think she'll treat the cubs differently. She does apparently give more attention to the female cub than she will the male, but while he's little, he will have the confidence of his sister. But once, of course, they start to hit puberty, then he will join the male hierarchy, and he'll start to be dominated by all the females. Oh, what a joy. I'm so glad we came down here. One decent decision I made all day. Don't you think, Pia? Mm-hmm. You're still not that impressed, are you? You must be impressed. We had baby tiny little hyenas. Were they not impressive?
No, I did go in.
You did. Mm-hmm. Good. All right, we're going to sit here for a little bit longer. And while we're doing that, let's head across and get an update from Byron and the leopard.
Welcome back, everyone. And I'm so happy James has been able to show you those hyena. I understand he's resorted to baby talk to try and get the cubs out. Let's hope he has a bit of luck. I'm not too sure that's going to work, though, but we'll see. We're still sitting with Mvula, such a beautiful male leopard, and he has not moved at all. Very, very comfortable and resting. Still out in the open though, it's still a little overcast, so nice and cool. So this leopard is very happy with lying out in the open, just resting, probably had a busy evening walking around. I understand he did finish a kill last night, I'm not too sure what it was. Something small, I think, but I'm not entirely sure. It was on a neighboring property, and then he crossed over into this area this morning. Great to be able to sit with him like this for a while. So Rich Levi has just asked an interesting question about a leopard and its hunting, and he would like to know how many impala a male leopard can go through in a year or hunt in a year. Rich Levi, I do not know. It's a very good question. The one thing about leopard is they have a They have a very wide variety of food that they will feed on, or prey species that they will hunt. Everything from small steenbok all the way up to large kudu. I've seen leopard feeding on many, many different animals. In terms of impala, it all depends on the leopard, depends on the area, depends. There are so many factors which go into it. You know, in my experience, I've seen male leopards maybe kill between 5 and 10 impala a month, possibly. Again, it all depends. It could be more in certain areas. So let's say, for example, a successful male leopard, maybe between 40 and 50 impala a year, probably more, maybe up to 60 or 70. But again, that's a rough guess. It's very difficult to gauge. But impala is one of the main prey species for a leopard. We can still hear that beautiful Varroa's eagle owl, or giant eagle owl, just calling about 100 meters away from us. I am going to see if I can find that for you just now. I have managed to spot it in a tree, so if we are lucky and it stays there, I might be able to show you that. We have had such a wonderful, wonderful sighting with Mvula. He's been very, very relaxed and comfortable and happy for us to sit around and watch him and view him. I think, why don't we move on, have a look if we can't find that giant eagle owl. That would be fantastic. And leave Mvula, maybe try again this afternoon, see if he has moved and what he gets up to. Let's continue. Thanks. I'm just going to try and move out of this little thick area over here. Why don't you go back to James with the hyena and see if he has got any update with those youngsters. Maybe those cubs have come out.
Quite the opposite. They've all gone inside. All of them have gone inside, everyone, I'm afraid. That is deeply irksome to me. What a pity. Well, we had a wonderful sighting. We'll sit here for another 5 more minutes. Yeah, my camera is here ready and waiting, of course, for me to take appalling photographs. There it is, VM. What do you think?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it's amazing, VM. Oh, look at that. I mean, you know, the quality of the photographs coming off this machine. Let's turn that off, clean the sensor. I embarrass myself further. Look, the baby ones, the baby's there. The baby's there. Aqua, you say, do I think that the urinating there was a function of the fact that she didn't want to leave with the baby here and the younger cub? No, Aqua, I don't think that at all. I think they just often do that. I just don't think they worry about where they go to the loo. I've seen them do it countless times, especially on hot days. So I don't think it had anything to do with the other cub. But that little one is playing in there. If only we could just get a little bit higher up, we'd be able to get a great view. There, it's coming out now. Look, look. Now, you know, it's so tiny, tiny, because it's got pointed ears still. The ears are still pointy at the top. They look like little devil's horns almost. Isn't that brilliant? Taking my camera out again, Liam. Liam's always amazed by the quality of my photography. Go away. What's the hyenas? That was an arty shot for him.
It will go well in the museum of out of focus shots.
Now, Jen, you want to know how many cubs there are. There are at least two of those little ones. Highly unlikely for there to be more than two tiny ones. Excuse me. Simply because that's normally what they give birth to. Two or three. Three is Three is very unusual. Three is very unusual, so it's most likely just one. Or two. Well, it's definitely two of these, but most likely just two. And then there is, of course, we know at least one of those January cubs. I'm calling that a January cub that we've been looking at. I don't know that for sure. It could be one of the Decembers, but it does beg the question as to where on earth the others are. And I don't know the answer to that. Very, very sleepy, relaxed, safe where they are, nice and warm, sheltered from the wind, lying in a puddle of her own urine, of course, which is deeply unpleasant if you're a human being, but well, it's fine if you're a hyena, I guess. And Elaine, you, very nice question from you. You say, do the higher ranking ones or lower ranking ones ever babysit for each other? Elaine, they do. They won't cross suckle, so unlike, for example, lions and sometimes elephants even, hyenas won't cross suckle each other's cubs, but they will look after each other's cubs. So one of them will stay and guard, well, not always, but sometimes one will stay behind at the den and guard the den. There she's up. What is she going to do? I think she's going to call it out again. Come on, call out your little baby. There's a little one, two little ones. You can see them both. Just slightly too small. Oh, great, she's weeing on their heads again. That's awesome. I don't know what that means, everyone. I'm sure it has a meaning greater than she just needs to relieve herself. I mean, I'm sure there's some reason she's doing that. I don't know what it is, though. I find it very odd. That little one is now spending more and more time outside. It's great. There it comes. Look. And it's almost impossible, I think, at this stage to be able to tell the difference between the two. But one, I don't know, it looks to me like one of them is slightly more confiding, slightly more confident than the other. I might be talking absolute nonsense, though. Definitely fascinated by us. They look like little wolverines, I feel. You might be able to hear them calling. There, she's suckling them now. How fantastic is this? And Kathy, you're wondering about the social structure as well. And just in case you don't know, hyenas have a highly matriarchal society. So the females are in charge. It's led by a matriarch. The hierarchy is strictly enforced with violence. And Kathy, you want to know if there's any way that a female can move up the hierarchy? No, I don't think there is. And if she's born to the royal lineage, the chances of her ever assuming control of the clan and being a high-ranking member of that royal lineage is very small. I've no doubt it's happened before. I've no doubt that, you know, some low-ranking hyena has been born that and she's beaten up. Maybe she's been bigger and she's beaten up the matriarch or the new matriarch. When the old matriarch dies, I've no doubt that's possible. But it doesn't happen often. And I think where you will find a slight change, maybe, is when there are two daughters of the matriarch, say they're only split by 2 years, and when the matriarch dies, they're both adults. Then I think you will see a fight for dominance. Marcel, nice question from you about are the predators coming to the den and whether or not the other hyenas would protect her, would come and aid her were, say, leopards or lions to come wandering past here. The answer, Marcel, is no. They wouldn't, and she would leave. She would leave these cubs here. If lions came walking through here, the cubs would disappear into the hole. They would be unreachable by any other predator, simply because there's a shelf at the back of the hole there that they dig themselves when they're born, onto which only they can get. And so even a very big predator like a lion would have absolutely no chance at all of sort of getting in there and hurting them. So she would just leave them. And no one would try and defend the den. And hyena are known sometimes for abandoning cubs and a den sort of in its entirety when predator pressure becomes too high. So while this looks like a very tender scene, it's not always so. Wonderful. We have been so very lucky here. So Sandy, the obvious question then is what will happen to the cubs of the highest ranking female if she was killed and they don't cross suckle? Well, if they were still suckling, Sandy, they'd die. Almost certainly. I'm afraid they would have no chance of survival. There they both are. This is too wonderful. I can't believe this. We're so lucky. When we got here, I didn't think we were going to see anything. I thought we'd just see her standing about the place. This is just brilliant. Oh. I do wonder where the rest of the clan is. I suppose they're probably off behind where, not behind the termite mound, sort of behind your screen, if you like, or behind the back of your head, behind us. There's the drainage line into which they went yesterday, and I wonder if that's not where they're sort of lurking now. Interesting theory from Mia Mycat saying, do I think that she urinates around them to keep the others away, sort of as a territorial marking almost. Yeah, Mia, that could well be possible. Yeah, absolutely. Right, while we wait and see if these little cubbies stick their heads out, Byron has found some frolicking elephants.
Have a look at this, everyone. Look at these young elephant playing. Oh, a beautiful lilac-breasted roller just landed and flew off. These elephants are playing, lying on top of each other, pushing each other. Fantastic. These are my favorite. I love watching these young elephants and their interaction. It's incredible. They were all lying on top of each other a few minutes ago as we found them. Have a look here, watch them. Pushing the logs around. Oh, there we go, look at them. Testing each other, playing, pushing. These are still very young, these elephants. One on the left's a little bit older. Look at the tusks that have just popped out. Have a look. Oh, quite a few years old. Oh, look at that. Amazing. Very, very social animals. These youngsters love to play and frolic, as James put it. And I suppose this, to an extent, teaches these elephant, or for future reference, when they do become, that one on the left, when is a male, a young male, when he does become a little bit older, he will have to fight and try and challenge another male for territory, or not territory, for dominance rather. So all of this is part of the learning curve, I suppose, challenging how they react, how they use their trunks and their tusks and pushing and playing. But this is all just purely play at the moment. Watch. Snoop has just asked a question about elephant and how many babies they are able to have in a lifetime. So Snoop, you're going to have to help me with my maths here a little bit. But I would say elephant will generally come into estrus for the first time, or be ready to mate. So sexual maturity, probably between the age of about 15 and 20 years old, maybe closer to 20 for females. And then their lifespan is about 50 to 60 years. So with an elephant, their gestation period is very long. It's 22 months. And once they have given birth, they only give birth to one calf at a time. Once they have given birth, they will raise that calf for anywhere up to 4 to 7 or 8 years before they decide to mate and have another calf again. Again, it's not an exact figure, but roughly around that time. So I think it might even be less, maybe 2.5 to 3 years before they decide to mate again. But I have seen adult females with much older calves. So with them raising young calves in that long gestation period, maybe only about 2 or 3 calves in a lifetime. Maybe an older female could maybe have more, but yeah, probably only 2 or 3 in a lifetime. It's not a lot, but it's a fair amount for a 50-year-old elephant. A lot of numbers there, and it's far too early in the morning for me to work out all those numbers. James is the mathematician of the team. Look at that beautiful lilac-breasted. Oh, it just was about to fly into your picture, but flew out again. Lilac-breasted roller. While these elephants are feeding, they are disturbing a lot of insects on the ground and in the trees. And often you get birds following them, like a lilac-breasted roller. Occasionally they fly down, swoop down, try and catch an insect that the elephant has disturbed, and fly off again. Good morning, Velma. Velma has asked if I've ever witnessed the birth of an elephant. or any other animal for that matter. Just have a look at that one lying down. Look at that. So, Velma, I've only seen a wildebeest giving birth. I have not seen elephant or any other animal. And it's funny, you know, in nature, there are certain animals that have certain breeding seasons and they give birth around the same time every year. Oh, look at that. So the wildebeest and impala are two prime examples of animals that have a strict mating season and they give birth at a certain time of the year. It's usually kind of for impala about the beginning to middle of November, and for wildebeest about the beginning of December, end of November, beginning of December. But even then, knowing that those females are going to give birth at that specific time of year, I still haven't been fortunate enough to see a lot of births. I think when animals do give birth, they are very secretive, very careful in a way, because they're obviously vulnerable while they are giving birth. But only once for me. I know a few of my friends that are guides, some of them have been a bit luckier and have seen two or three, but it is not something you see very often. Just going to move around a little bit. Let's keep an eye on these elephants. Heidi has just asked if there's a difference in age, or lifespan rather, between the Asian and the African elephant. Heidi, that's a good question. To be honest, I'm not entirely sure of the lifespan of an Asian elephant. I would assume it's pretty similar. So if anybody has got an answer for me on that, about the lifespan of an Asian elephant, I'd really appreciate it, because I'm not too sure. But I do think that their lifespan is possibly quite similar. I would guess maybe that Asian elephant might be a little bit less. But let's see if we can get someone to help us with that. These elephants are still... All right, so I have got an answer. The Asian elephant, and as I mentioned, my thoughts are correct. The Asian elephant do have a shorter lifespan, slightly shorter, about 48 to 50 years old. So it is a bit shorter than the African elephant.
Astonishing behavior. We've just seen this young male lion is chasing a giraffe, everyone. Unbelievable stuff. Sorry, I was momentarily distracted by a vehicle which nearly landed in Liam's lap. Let's just move in here. Did we pass him? We'll carry on here. So Liam can see him. We don't know who he is. There he is. I'm just going to move in here. Here he comes. Obviously the biggest holes all over Juma are in exactly where we are here. Now we're very close, everyone, to where Vula is. Don't know who this young male lion is. He looks a little bit nervous, so we're going to keep our distance from him. Beautiful, beautiful specimen. He's a teenager. There's a giraffe just in front of us. Get into a position where you can see the giraffe. Just ease our way through here. I mean, the chances of him taking down that giraffe, I imagine, are almost negligible, but who knows? There's the giraffe running now. And I think the lion is going to go through the gap in the bush here, if he hasn't already. Have you got him? There he is, well spotted. He's still going towards the giraffe. We'll try and get behind him.
So that's the same giraffe we saw last night. Now, what is this leopard lion doing? The leopard is really close by, everyone. He's not far from here at all. The giraffe, I'm assuming, is watching the lion, who now seems to be walking directly towards where the leopard is. You see the lion? Stations, lost visual of this young male. It seems like he's heading west along the game path, probably straight towards the Mbula sighting. How many stations in the Mbula sighting? Good. Copy that. I'm going to just follow this male and see where he goes. He's gone in here somewhere, everyone. And I think he's heading almost straight towards where Mbule is, because the giraffe is there and he's looking straight down in this direction. Just see if we can see his tracks. This is a very obvious game path where he may have gone, the lion, I mean. I don't see his tracks. See anything, Vimpy? I don't know where he's gone. Like I say, he did look a little bit nervous, so I don't want to go, like, you know, too close to him, startle him. Young male lion often nervous, of course, because he's the lowest end of lion society. Now the lion's just crossed behind there. Ease our way out. Just heard from Lex. He's gone into some bambili, I'm afraid. The lion. Well, at least we got a view of him. No idea who he is. He was, how fascinating. That giraffe we had last night. Same one. We'll just try and get out of the block here. And Byron is still with the elephants, so let's go across to him and see what the elephants are doing.
Well, that was an exciting little stint with James. I understand he had a lion chasing a giraffe, it sounded like. I'm not sure if you got to see it, but that is very, very exciting. I understand it's just crossed our border. Unfortunately, we've still been sitting with these elephants. They're happily feeding. We're now watching this adult breaking some of the stems from these bushes very close to us, probably about 5 meters away. Completely relaxed. The youngsters have moved off a little bit, but they're still in the area. They're not too far. They're just behind that, this adult. You can just see them off to the left, moving through the thicket. Quite a few elephants around here. Probably, I'd say about 8 or 10. There's still another one or two behind us. Some wildebeest in the background too. Just off to the right. There's some elephant moving through the back, and they are moving towards some wildebeest. A wildebeest. See this. Samson has just asked us a question about the drought and what percentage of the population will be affected by the drought. We fortunately have not quite hit a drought yet, and it may get very dry later in July. You know, we haven't had too much rain this year. It has been a very dry year for us in South Africa. And this area, fortunately, still has a little bit of water around, and there is still a lot of vegetation for these animals to feed on. From what I've seen, Shamson, in most areas, especially in East Africa and that, where you might have high drought season and animals struggling with drought, elephants still manage to find food and water. I don't think it's a very high percentage of the population that will suffer from the drought. It's difficult to give an exact number. I'm not too sure. From what I've seen and from what I've read, you might get, especially with the younger elephant, dying because they just don't have enough energy to keep up with the herd and they are not able to feed. So you might get maybe only 10 or 20%, I would say, in a serious drought that would suffer. And then as soon as there's a bit of rain, the elephant managed to find food and water again. And it's not necessarily the water, it's the issue, it's the food. As long as there's food around, they should be okay. They will find water and moisture somehow. They are incredibly intelligent. But it's difficult to say. It all depends on the seriousness of the drought. How dry is it? How much food is around? And it will depend how long that drought is for. It will also depend on how many elephants are affected by it. Beautiful female, this. So Maggie has asked if elephants die of natural causes, if lions would feed on them. Yes, Maggie, definitely. If an elephant, or most animals, if they die of natural causes, you will often get predators feeding on them, and especially something the size of an elephant. You will most likely get a hyena, but definitely lions, they will come through and feed on an elephant carcass. I have seen an elephant that has been killed by another elephant, a big, big bull. They had a dominance fight, and the one killed the other one. And the next day or so, a pride of lions found this elephant carcass, and they fed on the carcass for quite a few days. There's a lot of meat there. Once the lions moved off, the hyenas moved in. After hyenas, there were a lot of jackal around, and then plenty, plenty vultures. So there's always some animal that benefits from another animal's death. And speaking about vultures, I think James has got some to show you. Go have a look and see how many and what species of vulture he has.
Well, there are three. And their species, everybody, as I'm sure most regular viewers will know, is white-backed, the most common vulture that we get here. And the reason they're around, there are a whole lot of them around here, and that's because the Nkuhumas, or some lions identified as the Nkuhumas yesterday evening, killed a kudu not far from here. And so we're just near One Eye Pan, and that's where that lion's gone. I think he's gone probably towards where they are. I'm very interested that that lion felt comfortable enough to go towards that kill. Either he knows it's there or he can smell it. Because if that is the Nkuhumas, that's not Junior. So he's unrelated to them. And so the chances of them receiving him with great fondness are, well, negligible. That is a horrendous photograph. So there are all sorts of them around. Every dead tree around here, there are white-backed vultures sitting, waiting for the lions to move off their kill. And if their kill is in fact finished, in fact some of them look like they've got pretty full crops. There, if you look there, you can see there that sort of, that swollen patch of skin there. That's the crop, which is basically the throat of the vulture. It's like a pre-stomach almost. And it's full of meat. So obviously they've been eating. And maybe they're just sitting up here waiting for some warmer weather so they can fly off. Or just enjoying the fact that they don't have to look too far for food today. They're impressive birds, you know. Hello, Virginia in Kentucky. Very nice to hear from you, and of course, where you're from, although we do know you quite well, I suppose, Virginia. And you say, are any of the birds out here caught for food? Well, not vultures. Vultures are caught every so often, not for food, but for their use in traditional medicine. But there are birds that are very nice to eat out here, well, relatively nice to eat. You saw those guinea fowl earlier today. They are, well, they're edible. They're supposed to be a delicacy. If you go to a sort of South African-themed restaurant, you can almost certainly get guinea fowl to eat. I think you'll probably get it bred in the United States if you want it. I find it deeply stringy and very untasty. You can eat Franklins. They're not bad. What is very nice, however, are grouse, the grouse that we do get here. And not many of them around, so you could eat all of those birds. Apparently an Egyptian goose is also edible, but the most gamey kind of meat possible, apparently. Right, Byron apparently has an antelope to show you. Let's go and have a look at that.
How fantastic is that? You got to see four white-backed vultures with James just after I mentioned vultures. It's so fantastic to be able to link between each other and see what everyone is seeing around here while we are driving. And have a look what we have just found. A beautiful bushbuck ram. Now, we don't see many bushbuck around. They are quite secretive antelope. They prefer very dense thickets and generally areas where there is quite a lot of moisture and or water rather. Oh, don't know if you can hear that. There's some impala. It sounds like impala males. Those are not alarm calls. That is probably a few males just having a bit of a dispute, chasing each other. That's often the sound they make when they are rutting, but it is no longer rutting season. Well, the rut has actually just finished for them. So I think that's just probably males chasing each other, or male trying to chase some females around that he's trying to keep in his territory. Getting back to the bushbuck, these bushbuck prefer areas where there's some water and green vegetation. They prefer thickets. They're these fringe feeders. I mentioned leopard being a fringe hunter. They like to move around on the edge of drainage lines or thickets where they can watch a bit of the clearing and a bit of the thicket. And these fringe feeders, like a bushbuck or an inyala, often fall prey to leopard because they are in these thicker areas. But also very alert and very aware of what's going on around them. And those sharp little horns of a bushbuck can do some serious damage to a leopard. So they're very careful about hunting them. Now, interesting with the bushbuck, there are three species of antelope that fall under the same family. So the bushbuck, the inyala, and the kudu. Now, they're all under a family known as Trigelaphus, or genus rather, known as Trigelaphus. And the reason for that is they are all quite similar. So the bushbuck, inyala, and kudu all have white markings on the bodies, slightly different. Bushbuck has more spots, no, not really stripes. The kudu and the inyala both have very prominent white stripes down the body. They also have, with the horn structure, all three antelope have a twist in the horn. So bushbuck, much shorter horns, but they do twist slightly. The inyala have slightly longer horns with a bit of a curve and a twist. And then the male kudu with those beautiful spiral horns. So that is why they are all in the same genus. And interestingly enough, with these antelope, you'll often hear speaking about a kudu or any antelope bull or cow or a ewe or a ram. Now the interesting thing is it all depends on the size of the antelope where that split comes. So the antelope where we decide that split is actually the inyala. So anything smaller than an inyala, the females are ewes and the males are rams. And
anything larger than a Nyala, the females are cows and the males are bulls. However, with the Nyala, it's different. The female is a ewe, but the male is a bull. So that's the only difference. But the rest, everything larger, cow and bull, everything smaller, a ewe and a ram. It's quite nice, something different. It's always nice to see these different antelope that you don't often see, and nice to speak about them. We're going to continue. We're heading towards Vuyatela water hole. Just like to see if there's anything around the water, maybe some bird life. We've had a fantastic morning. David and I have been smiling from ear to ear, very happy, very excited. We got our leopard this morning, and a great elephant sighting starting off, and then now with these youngsters playing and frolicking and the adults feeding quite close to us. Still a very cool morning, so a lot of the animals will still be quite active. I think that's why there was that lion that came through very briefly. There's still a leopard lying out in the open. When it is cooler like this, and I mentioned it earlier, it's really great because the predators that are generally more active in the cooler times of the day or in the evenings do stay active a lot longer during the day because they don't have to put up with the heat. Jerry from Australia has asked one of my most memorable sightings in the bush. And Jerry, I mentioned one yesterday about wild dog chasing honey badger. That was one of my favorites. I think one of the other really great sightings I had was a sighting of a female leopard. That was stalking some impala. It was actually my very first leopard kill that I had seen from start to finish. Watched her stalking, she got really close to the impala herd, ran in and grabbed an impala very close to us, right in front of us, and everybody got to see it. It was amazing. But what made it even more incredible is after that, she dragged it to a very large tree. Let's just have a look. There's some elephant off to the left here. So as this female leopard dragged this kill off to this tree, she fed on it for about 10 minutes, then got up and moved off and started walking away. We followed her, and about a kilometer down the road, she started giving a very low contact call. When leopard and lion, it's quite a similar call, and they usually do that to call the young. It sounds like a ooh, ooh, ooh. And she was doing that, and the next thing, three cubs came out of the bush to greet this female. She then took all three cubs back to the impala kill that she had made, and all four leopard sat around. The female sat one side, and the three cubs started to feed. It's definitely one of my most memorable sightings. Look at these elephant, wow. Communicating, looks like. Two young males that are just, it's not a serious fight. I think these two males are probably testing each other more than anything else. And again, as I mentioned, you know, this is all part of the learning curve for them. This is how they challenge each other. They learn their strengths, their weaknesses, and when they get to a stage where they are dominant and ready to mate with females, then they will have to challenge males to be able to mate with different females from different herds. So all of this is a process that has to be done and has to be gone through. This slightly smaller one backing off a little bit. We've had great elephant interaction this morning. Yeah. This one definitely lost that battle, it looks like. There we go. Maybe we're lucky and they come and drink at the waterhole in front of us. Just sit quietly, give them a little bit of space and see what they decide. That raising his trunk. I think that one at the bottom is possibly smelling. Yeah, they'll often raise their trunks like that if they do pick up on the scent of something. One stumbled a little bit. Some grey go away birds at the water's edge. Let's see. Come on, come and drink for us. There we go. Oh, wonderful. James Richard has asked a question about when a bull elephant goes into must. James would like to know about that fluid which is secreted from the temporal gland and if it is changed during that period of must, the consistency of it and the hormones. James Richard, yes, definitely. It would change. Generally with the males though, they only sweat and secrete liquid from that temporal gland when they are in must. So generally it would be made up of a lot of hormones, a lot of testosterone. That is what that gland is secreting over there for the males. I think with the females it may be slightly different depending on the situation that they are in. I mentioned earlier, and we saw that on the female early this morning, she was secreting, that's possibly just also a lot of hormones. Occasionally they will do it in a state of euphoria or in stress, so it does vary and it does depend, but I think with males generally it stays the same. It's when they are a heightened sense of testosterone and a lot of hormones, and that's when they come into must. Did you notice how those elephants would suck up the water with their trunks and then spray it a little bit, then suck it up and spray it? They will often do that because elephants are quite fussy drinkers. They like to have clean water, so they will suck up the water, spray it, and try and get the cleaner water coming through and get some of the dirt away, and they will drink that water. Okay, I think James, I don't think, I know, James has gone to see a leopard. Perhaps he is with the Mvula again. Why don't you go have a look and see if the leopard has moved and what he is up to.
Not Mvula, everybody. Sitting on a termite mound, as was his wont as a little cub. Sundile. Hello, fella. There he is. Isn't that fantastic? Look at him there. He looks like he's had a meal. This is brilliant. I mean, we're sitting some distance from him, probably about, Viam, what does your focus say?
45 meters.
45 meters away from him, so roughly 150 feet. He certainly looks like he's swallowing something. Beautiful shot. He's a distinctive looking animal, this. I don't know why he's breathing like that.
Hairball time.
He's either got a hairball. He looks like he might be sick.
No, that's hairball.
Does look like a hairball. Looks very uncomfortable. That's not uncommon, everybody. Leopards do this. They have these kind of reflexive movements of the diaphragm and the belly, and I'm sure he's going to... There we go. Oh,
That was a delightful thing to see. Don't know what it was. We can go a bit closer. I'm just gonna wait for yours to get in there. I think he's still pretty comfortable with vehicles, this dealer, but I don't want him to have to hear two of us bashing in there at the same time. Now, these are those strychnos bushes I was talking about. Byron from the other vehicle, like I say, is taking off where his friend Brent Leo Smith left off, saying, am I only able to find collared leopards? The answer is quite possibly, but at least I didn't have to be told where it was. Let's ease our way in here. And I think we'll get a lovely view. Now, his mum, Shadow, who you all know very well, or many of you know very well, and he used to always sit on termite mounds, much more than any other leopards I've ever known. I think he's moving. There he goes, straight in front of us there. This is a very, very thick block, everybody, so it's not going to be easy to get through. Let's just watch him for a little while and see him disappear through there. We'll try and keep up with him. This is his old hunting ground. This is where he's cut his teeth as a little leopard. How are yours? Good, how are you? Good morning, huh? They've, of course, had wild dogs right at their dam. Okay, I think while we crunch through this lot, everybody, I think let's go back to Byron and his elephants. I think it's going to be quite noisy and unpleasant, so let's go back to Byron and we'll see what we can find through here.
That's fantastic. So you got to see two different leopards this morning. That's really great. We are still sitting with now four elephant bulls at the waterhole. This one on the right standing close to the water looks like the bigger, more dominant one. As he walked down, the rest moved out of the way very quickly. So James has had an interesting morning. Hyena weeing on its cub and a leopard vomiting. Beautiful reflection in that water now, that elephant, look at that. Fantastic, great for photography. Crystal clear. There's two younger bulls that are, you can see in the background there, still challenging, fighting, playing with each other, pushing each other around. Oh, there we go. See, splashing the water again. Hope we get these males drinking. So what often happens with these big dominant males, these younger males will follow them around. Oh, there's a beautiful view of him drinking. These younger males will follow them around. And the reason for that is these bigger dominant bulls will teach these males how to be successful, how to find females, and what to do. Also, if they are looking for food and water. Let's see how he reacts to these two youngsters. Look at that. Amazing interaction. I mean, who really knows what is going on there? Are they potentially just acknowledging the bull, showing respect. See how they stopped when he faced them. Incredible behavior. That's what I find so fascinating about this, is he, I mean, we don't really know. We don't really understand. We can interpret it as much as we possibly can and what we understand. But there's a clear dominance show going on here. This big bull is showing his dominance towards these younger ones, and it's almost as if he's saying to them, look, you know, I'm trying to have a drink here, behave yourselves. But I guess this also comes into that learning curve for the younger elephant and how this bull teaches them. See, spraying water again. The one on the right is spraying a little bit of water. Oh. A big male just pushed the other one off to the side. James has managed to find Sandile again and moving through that block. Go and have a look and see what that leopard is getting up to. Always great to follow a leopard while it's moving.
This leopard is not moving, everybody, but he's lay down so close to us. And you can get a good look at his collar there. And while I know it looks very unwieldy, it looks like an unpleasant thing for him to have on, it will eventually fall off as he goes older. There you can see him just listening to us, his ears twitching to and fro. Very special. What I'm going to do, he's so relaxed here, that I think there's a herd of buffalo moving off in front of us. I'm just going to sneak around the front of him. It'll be a little bit noisy. A nice question from James Richards saying, is there any particular aspect of leopard behavior that I have observed to be sort of indicated incorrectly in guidebooks? And so there's a whole herd of buffalo in front of us here, actually. I can just see moving through the shadows there. James, good question. Do you mean, I suppose, like it is with wild dogs, where they say that they're the most successful hunters, etc., etc.? Oh, a scrub hare just shot up out of the bush. That's what he saw. It was sitting only a meter from where I am sitting now. That's what he spotted. Oh, shame. He was probably going to eat it if I hadn't frightened it away. Not sure he saw it, though. There, he's up. Isn't he lovely? This is so special. Trotting there. I think he's going to trot up onto this termite mound. Silent, silent footfalls. He's just looking where that rabbit went, not rabbit hare. James, I guess the most obvious one would be that most guidebooks will tell you that they're nocturnal, which they patently are not, and that they hunt normally at night. Most leopard hunting behavior I've ever seen has been during the day. I don't want to move, just in case that scrub hare is actually closer than I think it is. Now that, you see how I'd lifted his tail? Because those green wood hoopoes have spotted him, and they're making a noise and alarm calling at him. He's just lifted his tail as a sort of sign of surrender. I don't want to move, just in case that scrub hare is just around the termite mound there and he's spotted it again. He's definitely just spotted the buffalo. I don't think the scrubhead will move. Let's move around a little bit around the side. What do you think, Vim? Other side? We'll just wait here.
Get a nice view.
Get a nice view? Yeah. He's very gold, I think, compared with his mother. And you can see he's got tall. He spotted it, I think. He's taller than his mum. He's like a teenager that hasn't filled out yet. This is fantastic. Here we sit with Africa's prince of cats. He's totally ignoring us, which I find amazing, especially given his experience. They're infinitely patient, you know, when they're on the hunt like this. And you can maybe just hear the scuffling of leaves. That's the buffalo. There they are. He won't be thinking about one of those. Well, not unless he's feeling particularly stupid today. I would go round the front, everyone, to see his face, but I think we'll make a big noise. Looks like he's poised in some way. I wonder if we can see that scrub hair. Let's go around the other side. Let's see if we can. Now the buffalo are just coming around the corner here. Nice view here, I hope. Say when, Vimpi?
When?
It's quite a nice shot. You can hear the oxpeckers calling. Him watching very carefully there. So we'll sit here for the rest of the drive. Just see if he doesn't do something amazing. Well, his very nature being here is amazing, isn't it? Tail twitching all the time. I think he's thinking about going up the termite mound. Now, everybody, we're going to probably have to, well, we're going to have to leave you in about a minute's time. We're not going to go back to Byron. We're going to stay here with the leopard and see what he does. I wonder if he's not going to pop up just behind us. Over the top of the termite mound. Come on, stick your head up over the top. Maybe he won't. Anyway, thanks everybody for coming along with us. It's been a wonderful drive. Lions and leopards and hyenas and elephants. Brilliant stuff. Thank you, Vian, for your efforts. Big thank you to Byron, of course, being filmed by Davey, I think, this morning. We'll see you this afternoon at 3:30. Sorry, at 3:00. Until then, stay safe and happy wherever you are in the world. And let us not forget to thank Rebecca in the final control, being helped by Chelsea. Until then, see you later.